We're going to be having Professor Marek Kornat, Director of the Department of History of the 20th Century, and of the Section for the History of Diplomacy and Totalitarian Systems of the Polish Academy of Sciences in Warsaw, Poland. And issue here will be two totalitarian powers against Poland, the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pacts, August, September 1939. Professor Kornat, good morning. Dzień dobry.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I will be speaking today on the Pact Ribbentrop-Molotov of August 23 and the second Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact of September 28. I think we all know that the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact belongs to the most fateful events in the history of the 20th century. In my short presentation, I will try to concentrate myself not on the repetition of the well-known negotiations leading to this agreement, but on the most controversial problems connected with this tragic history, tragic for Poland, first of all, because Poland was the first victim of these two totalitarian powers. Let me repeat one thing. In 1932 and 1934, Polish government, in the last years of Marshal Piłsudski's life, achieved a visible improvement of the international position of Poland. Poland concluded two agreements on non-aggression. One of them, the first one, was with the Soviet Union in 1932. Second, it was Polish-German non-aggression declaration, concluded shortly after the Hitler's accession to power in Germany. Polish-German and Polish-Soviet agreements permitted Poland to start policy of balance between Berlin and Moscow, policy of equilibrium, polityka równowagi in Polish. Polish-German non-aggression agreement had no mentioning on the borders question, on the territorial dispute between Poland and Germany. It said only one thing, that the future relations between both countries will be based on the Bianca-Lok Pact of 1928. And this pact was the pact on the rejection of the use of force in resolution of the international disputes. One thing should be underlined, I think. For the Soviet Union, for the Polish eastern neighbor, the reopening of the conflict between Poland and Germany was a very positive factor. Stalin calculated for exploitation of Polish-German enmity, because this conflict would lead to the destabilization of Europe, of European order. Soviets were not reconciled with the Versailles order, with all the decisions, territorial decisions, which were made in Paris 1919, and especially they were not reconciled with the long perspective with the Riga territorial settlement of 1921. It was a great illusion to speculate for Soviet help, for Soviet aid in a future war against aggressive Germany. After 5 years of Polish-German detente, we had the new reopening of the Polish-German conflict. In the end of 1939, 1938, German government proposed a special solution, general solution in Polish-German relations. It was based on the conception of territorial demands to Poland concerning free city of Gdańsk, and secondly, extraterritorial connection between Germany and Eastern Prussia. And secondly, Germany proposed Poland a special offer, an offer of a junior partner against the Soviet Russia. As you know, Polish government initially rejected the proposal. Colonel Beck visited Hitler in Berchtesgaden in the beginning of January 1939, and he repeated the negative response. And in March, after the dissolution of Czechoslovakia, the Polish-German consultations ended, and the open conflict between Warsaw and Berlin was a reality in Europe. In March 1939, the military conflict between Poland and Germany seemed to be really unavoidable. In the last decade of March 1939, the British government offered Poland a guarantee of independence. It was made in the House of Commons by British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain. Beck responded positively, and he was invited to London. After short conversations in London at the beginning of April 1939, a provisional Polish-British defensive alliance against Germany was concluded. The idea of the new partition of Poland was vital in Moscow. One testimony is important for this thesis. I mean the words of Vladimir Potyomkin, the deputy of the People's Commissar for Foreign Affairs in Moscow, in his conversations with the Western diplomats. I mean the conversation of October 1938 with French ambassador to Moscow, Robert Coulondre, and with Italian ambassador to Moscow, Augusto Rosso. He said that the new partition of Poland is unavoidable. It is in autumn, it was said in autumn 1938. It is very, very important fact for the story of the genesis of the Ribbentrop-Molotov or Hitler-Stalin pact. Conflict between Poland and Germany was an extremely positive factor for Moscow. I repeat this observation. First signal of the Soviet eagerness to cooperate with Germany was made at the beginning of March, and it came from Moscow. I mean Stalin's speech on the Party Congress on March the 10th. It produced a special ad memoir of the German Foreign Ministry, Auswärtiges Amt. It was prepared under the title Russlands Außenpolitisches Neuorientierung, New Orientation of Russian Foreign Policy. Why Stalin wanted a pact with Germany? The response for this question is not difficult. He imagined the territorial reconstruction of the European order. He wanted a new partition of Poland. He said it secretly but openly to the chief of the Communist International, Georgi Dimitrov, at the beginning of September 1939. It should be observed that future cooperation with the Nazi Germany was calculated in Moscow only on the basis of territorial division of the spheres of influence or interests in the Eastern and Central Europe. Without this political basis, new Soviet-German agreement was impossible. In April 1939, Stalin began his double game. On the same day, on April 17, Soviet government proposed a defensive pact, and this proposal was communicated by Litvinov, foreign commissar of the Soviet Union, to foreign minister of France, Bonnet, and foreign minister of Britain, Viscount Halifax. And on the same day, Soviet embassy in Berlin communicated the idea of the necessity of the starting of talks between both governments. Soviet government proposed anti-German defensive alliance and started to bring together Germany and Russia. Unfortunately, in the second half of May 1939, the British government took a decision on the necessity of an alliance of the Western powers, Britain and France, with the Soviet Union. This was an illusion of the government in London and Paris, and it was an illusion of the public opinion in both capitals. There is no need today to argue that such a great alliance of Moscow, Paris, and London against Germany was absolutely impossible. It was excluded. Stalin calculated for the division of the capitalist states and for the war between them, wanted to exploit this conflict for his interests. The Great Coalition, the Grand Alliance, was impossible. The Western powers, we can conclude, the Western powers spent time for the counterproductive negotiations with Moscow in summer 39. I mean political negotiations, and I mean also military negotiations in the second half of August 39. Hitler's choice for détente and for cooperation with Soviet Union was taken in summer 1939. It is probable, however, it is not clear so far, that it was taken by Hitler under the influence of von Ribbentrop, who advocated the tactical alliance with the Soviet Union against Poland. Germany wanted to isolate Poland. Poland should be isolated because it could permit to start a local war, and to eliminate Poland by a new partition of her two neighbors, Germany and Russia. Hitler had no confidence to Russia. He was the partisan of the idea of Lebensraum in the Eastern Europe, the vital space. It is true, but initially he wanted a tactical short-term agreement with Soviet Russia to eliminate Poland. To eliminate Poland by an isolated war. Hitler calculated, that after reaching an agreement with Moscow, the Western powers will do nothing for Poland. The negotiations between the Western powers and the Soviet Union in Moscow reached no progress in July and in August 39. In the critical moment, the Soviet government raised the demands for a free passage of the Red Army through Polish territory. Germany and Russia had no common border, And in this situation, Soviet Commissar of Defense, Voroshilov, Marshal Voroshilov, said that it is necessary to enter of Soviet troops on Polish territory because this is only one possibility to reach contact with Wehrmacht. Polish government was not informed on this decision by the Soviet diplomacy, but the conception was transmitted to London and Paris, and Foreign Minister Franz Bonnet informed on it Polish ambassador in Paris. Polish government rejected, as you know, rejected to appease Soviet demands. We can say now that it was absolutely impossible to take any other decision. How was it possible to permit for the enter of Soviet army on Polish territory before the war, in the peace situation? It would be the end of Poland's independence. Marshal Śmigły-Rydz said officially that after coming of Soviet troops on Polish territory, they will stay here, and it is not probable that they would initiate military actions against Germans. It was highly improbable. It exists a controversial problem of the initiation of the negotiations leading to the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact. Some historians, especially these of left-wing orientation, argued that the initiative was German and that Stalin was forced to choose Hitler because Poland rejected the proposals on the passage of the Red Army. It is necessary to respond that initiative belonged to Soviet diplomacy. Soviet diplomacy was always eager to start negotiations on the territorial changes in the Central and Eastern Europe. Only final step leading to the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact was initiated by Hitler in his personal letter to Stalin, in which he asked Stalin for acceptance of the Ribbentrop's visit to Moscow. The initiative belonged to the Soviets. The Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact was composed, you know about it, I think, of the two separate documents. Publicly announced political treaty on non-aggression and the secret additional protocol. They were dated for 23 of August. Polish government had no informations, no serious informations on the secret protocol. It is true, in the light of Polish diplomatic documents, that two ambassadors in the Western capitals, I mean Edward Raczyński in London and Juliusz Łukasiewicz in Paris, had leakages on the substantial stipulations of the secret protocol, but only concerning the Baltic states. Foreign Minister Bonnet said to Łukasiewicz that the Baltic states were divided. Lithuania will be under German occupation, but Latvia, Estonia and Finland will be in Soviet sphere of interests. In the last moment before the conclusion of the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact, Ambassador Raczyński tried to discuss the situation with Viscount Halifax, but his advice was unproductive. Advice to British foreign minister, Raczyński said that in case of German-Soviet collusion, only the effectivity of Polish-British alliance would change the situation. Pact Ribbentrop-Molotov could be avoided, but only after active engagement of Britain and France in the war on the side of Poland. This was, of course, out of political plans in London and Paris. Two capitals had good information on the secret protocol. I mean France. Ambassadors of France in Berlin and in Moscow received concrete information on the secret protocol. Ambassador in Berlin, Coulondre, and ambassador in Moscow, Najjar, sent secret telegrams to the capitals of his countries. But the French government did nothing to inform Polish government on it. Bonnet admitted only that the decision on the future of the Baltic states was taken. He said that the French government had no information on Poland. And second country, second government was the United States. Ambassador in Moscow, Lawrence Steinhardt, received serious information on the substance of the secret protocol on 24th of August 1939 and sent a telegram to Foreign Secretary Cordell Hull, to the Department of State, and American government also did nothing to inform Poland. Only ambassador in Paris, William Bulit, had a conversation with Łukasiewicz. It was in the last hours of peace on 31st of August, and he informed Polish ambassador on the decision taken concerning the Baltic states. Polish government, having no information on the secret protocol, had no solution. Poland was condemned for partition. Beck achieved only one thing. He entered Poland to the international coalition, political coalition with the Western powers. I will not be speaking on the events of September 39, but I will try to concentrate in my presentation on the second Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact, I mean this of 28th of September. This pact changed the decision of the two governments in Moscow and in Berlin concerning the border on the partitioned Poland. As you know, initially in August 39, it was decided to proclaim this line on three rivers, Narew, Vistula, and San. And now, after short negotiations of Ribbentrop with Stalin and Molotov in the end of September, a new line was proclaimed. It was the line on the Bug River, leaving Lviv on the Soviet side. New border was established. I think that one question should be opened. I think that it was rather better choice for Poland, for Polish nation, that this new line was proclaimed. Because in this situation, such regions of Poland, like a large part of Mazovia or Lublin, belonged to the German occupation. In case of their place on the Soviet side, it would be more Polish soldiers, Polish officers on the Soviet side, Polish people of the elites, and Soviet governments should exterminate them after the war. I don't want to say that German occupation was positive alternative for Poland, but German exterminatory policy was rather in long-term perspective in plans of Berlin. And led me to conclude in three sentences. The tragedy of Poland was unavoidable. The capitulation on the side of Soviet Union or Germany was impossible. This was the decision not only of the Polish government, but also of the overall Polish nation. Secondly, Ribbentrop-Molotov agreements were directed not only against Poland, they were the revolutionary acts attempted against the Europe of the free nations. You must remember that Europe was rebuilt after the Great War. It was rebuilt on the self-determination principle. It appeared a geopolitical revolution in Europe after the collapse of three multinational empires. As Professor Viktor Sukiennicki observed, it was a geopolitical revolution in Europe. And they wanted, both totalitarian governments wanted to revert this geopolitical revolution and to establish totalitarian domination. This is the European dimension of the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact. And last observation, the lesson of the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact for us, for today, shows us that the geopolitical interests are more important than ideology, than ideological differences. Thank you very much.